All right. Hello and very good morning to all of you. I am Dr. Nagaraj Hegde, and along with me is Dr. Suresh Kumar. We, on behalf of Department of Forestry and Mizoram University, welcome you all to today's webinar. This webinar is focusing on two important topics in the field of forestry, and it is aimed at basically students, scholars, young scientists, and forestry in forestry and other related fields. We are happy that so far we have received very good response. We are very fortunate that we are joined by our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor K.R.S. Sambhashiva Rao. Without his support and guidance, this program wouldn't have been possible. I welcome you, sir. And joining us today are two eminent speakers in the field of tree improvement and wildlife conservation, Professor R. Vasudeva and Sri S.D. Bhatt, who will take you through their respective talks as we begin the sessions. I heartily welcome Professor Vasudeva sir and also Sri S.D. Bhatt sir. Welcome sir. Once again, I welcome all the panelists as well as attendees to today's webinar. First up, let me introduce our first guest, Professor Vasudeva, to all the audience who are joining us today. He is a professor at University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad, and an expert in the field of forest biology and tree improvement for the past 26 years. He has many achievements to his credit. I will try to read out a few. Professor Vasudeva is the recipient of prestigious INSA Teacher Award for the year 2018. He has served as an expert appraisal committee of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. He was also an expert member of Western Ghats Conservation Task Force for 5 years. He was an invited speaker in the very important COP11 meeting which was held in the year 2012. He has more than 120 publications, nearly about 2000 citations, and a global patent for a molecule which has a potential to cure cancer. He has successfully established forest gene banks for 3 endangered species, field gene banks for around 120 pickling mango varieties, and also he and his team have rescued a critically endangered plant in Western Ghat region. Before I hand it over to Professor Vasudeva, a few instructions to our attendees and participants that here, whenever you have any question, you have to pose your questions only in the question and answer option given below on your screen, not on the chat option. So I repeat, only on the question and answer option given here, not on the chat option. So with that, we can start. Professor Vasudeva sir, if you are ready, it's over to you now.
Thank you. Thank you so much. First of all, I would like to thank the Mizoram University for this wonderful opportunity. Many thanks to the Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, and my friend also, Dr. Nagaraj, and all the staff there. Let me share my slide. I think, am I audible, Nagaraj, now?
Yes, sir. You're
right. Yeah. So my name is Professor Vasudeva. I come from University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad. It's my pleasure to talk to you today and share my thoughts on tree improvement at a glance. When I actually agreed to this particular topic, I thought I have taken a very large topic to be condensed in about 40 minutes time. I will try to do my best how we can go about it. Just to give you a hint of where do we come from, we come from southern part of India. This is Karnataka state. And in Karnataka state, Uttar Kannada is located right in the Western Ghats. As you can see here, this is the beautiful Sharavati Valley, river valley in Uttar Kannada, near to my College of Forestry, Sirsi. Our college has produced more than 32 IFS officers and about 300-400 range forest officers who are serving all over the country, and then they are the custodians of this forest. I am from this proud Institute of College of Forestry, Sirsi. Let me begin my talk by asking a simple question, that how old is the art of tree improvement? Did it start with plus tree identification? Did it start with identification of the provenance? In order to answer this question, perhaps we should look at this particular sculpture that is found in present-day Iraq, somewhere in the near Tigris River, in the palace of Nimrud.
Professor Vasudeva, your screen.
Screen is sharing?
Yeah.
Share it now. Is it audible now? And you're seeing this?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Fine.
So just to give one slide back, I am from this place called Sirsi. And as what you are seeing here is the beautiful Saravati Valley in the Western Ghats. So let me ask this question of how old is the tree improvement. So in order to answer this question, perhaps we should look at the Syrian sculpture that is dating back to around 3000 years before present. And it's a bas relief sculpture, which actually depicts fertility ritual. As you can see here, a winged genie or a priest is trying to put something onto the flowers of date palm. In fact, this is a ritual where the winged god or the priest collects this sacred dust from a particular tree, pollinates onto the flowers of the date palm tree. The belief is that the yield and quality of the dates would improve. From today's perspective of tree improvement, if you look at, it's fair to assume that the Assyrians knew about the sexuality of the date palm. As you know, date palm is a bisexual in the sense that you have dioecious plant, male and female plants are separate. So they knew about the male plant and the female plant, and they knew about the pollination system. When they say it's a sacred dust, it's perhaps the pollen grains that are actually collecting. And they also knew about the maturity period of the pollen. And the religious fact tells that if you collect it from a specific tree and pollinate onto the flowers of date palm, the yield and quality would increase. It appears that they also knew the control of the parentage. So essentially, this sculpture tells us that everything that is depicted in the form of a religious function here actually tells about different aspects of tree improvement followed almost 3,000 years back. My second example comes from India. You know about Chanakya, who was the prime minister of Chandragupta Maurya, almost about 150 AD, who wrote this very famous Arthashastra. This is authentic Arthashastra sculpture, script. In this Arthashastra, he has given a detailed account of how different provenances of sandalwood can be categorized based on the aroma and the color. And perhaps this is the first description of provenance diversity in any tree species in the world. The third example comes from, again, a Syrian coast 4,000 years before present. Greeks used to maintain old olive tree groves, especially for seed collection. And the seed collected would be used specifically for the planting purposes. They believed that these are the most sacred trees that are the bounty that is given by the gods. So this is exactly akin to the present day seed orchard concept. So the fourth example is about coming from the Egypt, which is almost 1,500 years back. Egyptians used to cultivate an edible fig, which has been selected as a food for desert travel. They used to collect it, the fruits like this, collect it in these olive jars, big olive jars. So essentially, looking at all these examples, one can say that the tree domestication and the tree improvement, in fact, started with human civilization itself. So though it started as an art, they would not have known about the science behind it, or they would not have coined the terms that we use today But essentially, they were practicing tree domestication and tree improvement since the ages of almost 4,000 years back. So currently, the tree improvement is now being taught under three related terms: forest genetics, forest tree breeding, and then forest tree improvement. Going to the very basics of it, and if you look at what exactly constitutes a forest genetics, suppose you are looking in the here at a white teak flower. We also have in some countries a teak flower which is purplish in color. So if somebody asking a question, what is the genetic basis of this flower color, or what are the chromosome numbers of these different tree species? What is the genetic diversity in a population? So if you answer these questions, which are very basic, without any connotation to the actual tree improvement or the applied aspect of it, then this constitutes what we call it as the tree genetics. Coming to the tree breeding, suppose you're developing a hybrid, you're selecting a tree, plus tree, you're developing a pest resistant genotype, if you are improving a wood quality of the trees, or essentially if you're tailoring the genetics of a tree species for the needs of the human, then we are actually doing tree breeding. Tree improvement, which is the term perhaps coined by Professor Scott in 1953, actually is a combination of both the skills of tree breeding and silviculture. In tree breeding, we control the parentage, or what is the parentage of the offspring and the parent. And in silvicultural system, we take the management skills of giving optimum growing conditions to the plants. A combination of these two is perhaps, we call it as the tree improvement. Overall goal of the tree improvement is to get the desirable quality timber. And today, tree improvement is not necessarily be restricted to timber alone as a product. It could be any NTFP, or even the, if it is a medicinal tree species, it could be an excellent chemical that is also there. But getting this production of quality material product in maximum amount and in the shortest period of time and at a reasonable cost. Here is, time is called the most important non-commercial input in tree improvement. Basically because trees are long-lived organisms, seed to seed generation takes almost decades. And for this reason, anything that actually reduces the period of time to arrive at a particular product is highly required. So overall goal of the tree improvement is about these three. In a typical tree improvement program, this is what I'm going to explain in five different steps. There are five different steps that needs to be followed. This slide is a little longer. Let me read it for you. The first step is a determination of the species and the geographic source that should be used in a given area. Second is the determination of amount, kind, and causes of variability in a species. The third step is packing of the desired qualities into improved individuals. And the fourth one is mass production of improved individuals for operational level planting. And the fifth and the most important is developing and maintaining a genetic base population broad enough for advanced generations. These are little more textual and a little more technical. Suppose if you break this into some of the simple questions in plain English, the first step is nothing but which species to use or which provenance to use. The second question is that what is the level of variability that you can find in a particular character of your interest? How is it controlled? The third is how do we get all the desirable qualities in one go? And the fourth one is how do we mass produce once we have a couple of plus trees back in our lab or nursery? And the fifth one is how do we secure the future? My rest of my talk will revolve around these particular five steps. The tools, the methods, the procedures, and the protocols that we have evolved is basically for answering these questions. Let me go to the first question or the first step, determination of the species and the geographic source that should be used for tree improvement. In fact, this is a very strange question for the tree improvement. Suppose you go to a crop breeder, like a rice breeder, wheat breeder, maize breeder, they will not have this question at all. But come to Western Ghats, you have 5,000 species of tree species. Which one is going to be important in the next decade? Remember that tree improvement takes around a decade of time. Suppose you start with a wrong subject or a wrong species or a wrong provenance, you will end up in a deep trouble. For instance, teak, sandal, sal, eucalyptus, bamboo, these are all extremely important. There is a sustained demand for decades together. It's fine to start it. 30 years back, would anybody have thought about biofueling yielding plants? They only are becoming important right now. High value drug yielding trees become immediately important. For instance, if there is a specific a tree that yields a medicine to corona, the COVID-19, that would become an important issue here. So that's why this particular question is important. And which geographic source should be used or focused for planting is also important. If you have not got the depth of this question, let me tell you a story of the identification of true cinchona, just to highlight how important it is for us to now look at what is the most important providence to be used. What you see here is a flowering branch, and the bark is used for production of the quinine. This story goes back to the World War, where more European and US soldiers were dying because of malaria than because of the bullets in the war. So it was very strategic to control malaria in the army. So quinine was the only drug available, and it was actually supplied by Colombia. So essentially, it was strategic to grow cinchona outside Colombia. But the Colombian government had put an embargo that no export of the seed material would be allowed to go out of the country. So obviously, for many countries, the only option they left out was to smuggle it out. So get some seeds out of Colombia and then grow it elsewhere. The Dutch, in fact, the Dutch government commissioned the director of Botanical Garden, his name is Justus Hasrakel, in order to go to Colombia, South America, all the way from Europe, collect the seeds of the right kind, come back and plant it in Java. It appears that Justus Hasrakel went to the South American continent and exchanged one bag full of gold coins for 21 boxes of seeds and seedlings of cinchona. And then he brought to Java, and then he started growing. He was even given a knighthood. But unfortunately, all of them had extremely poor yield of the quinine, and it was a very poor yielding provenance. It was a decade of testing was actually wasted. Then came another sailor called Charles Ledger. He went again back to South America. He prevailed on a tribal man called Manuel Incra, and Manuel Incra showed him the right kind of the cinchona tree. But when he came back and gave it to this seeds of this particular tree, the Dutch government gave him only $20 because they had bitten a very bitter pill, more bitter than perhaps quinine in the earlier episode. But the plantation was raised using this particular seed material brought for the second time by Charles Ledger, and that had fantastic quinine, and Dutch had a monopoly of producing 97% of the world quinine by 1930. So one good provenance changed the entire course of a nation for an investment of less than $20. Today, cinchona is named after Cinchona Ledgeriana because of this reason. So friends, you should now understand that use of the right kind of the provenance, right kind of the species, right kind of the subspecies is the most important step in tree improvement program. Coming to the second step, this step is about determining the amount, kind, and what is the kind of variability that we have. As a tree breeder, I may wish to have a teak tree that grows at a rate of, let's say, 15 centimeters per annum. But do we have such a tree species? Do we have such a individual in the natural population? We do not know. Even if you have a particular individual which grows at this particular rate, it may not be genetically controlled. So identifying what is the total amount of variability and how is it genetically controlled forms the most important aspect of the second step. Friends, look at here. This is called Garcinia indica, which is a tropical tree species, which is a $1 million baby today, which yields a chemical called hydroxycitric acid. Normally, you find this particular kind in plenty. And these three variabilities have been identified by our group. And incidentally, this particular group of genotypes yield vitamin C, which is 15 times more than oranges. So that's the kind of variability that is there. In fact, scientists believe that trees are the most diverse organisms next to fungus that is found on this earth. All our tree improvement has to be identifying the right kind of the tree that contains all the desirable properties. Of course, here the genetic variation is the basis for a tree improvement. Understanding this variation, how it is controlled, forms the basis for, in fact, tree improvement program. For this, we do what is called as common garden experiments. The common garden experiment is essentially a plantation. What I bring is, I bring tree populations corresponding to different geographical origins are brought. These are called as provenances. And then they are grown in a common orchard, and then they're compared. There is a long tradition in the entire nation that we have provenance testing is being done for majority of the species. In India, there are more than 145 species that have been subjected to provenance testing. In fact, provenance testing can be done using extensive seedling nursery comparison. You can also use a growth chamber or a field garden experiments can also be made whenever you want to compare and identify the best species. Just to give an example of our own study, Dicerzellum banecteriferum, one of the major timber species of the Western Ghats, when we compared, which is also found in the Northeast provenance showed almost double the growth of the Western Ghat provenance. And this is where we can improve the yield and the quality by looking at just what is there in the nature. In fact, people are now trying to look at adaptation to climate change. This is an example from Sitka spruce. This particular material has been brought from almost Alaska to California. They have been grown here. And by growing, I can know that the Californian provenance is much better than the Alaskan government. As you go towards north, the growth actually reduces. We also have several examples. This is a balsam poplar that's growing in a common garden in a Vancouver experiment. As you can see, there's a beautiful provenance here. In fact, provenance studies help the breeders to match which seed sources are very good for a particular target site. In fact, by matching the correct provenance with the right kind of site, we can achieve a significant genetic gain. The third step is about packing the desirable qualities into an individual. Though we call it as a packing of desirable qualities into one individual or a population, most of the times we do resort to what is called as plus tree selection. We go and identify an individual which already has all the qualities in it. So the starting point of a tree improvement program, most often that's why starts with plus tree identification. Plus tree is nothing but which is an individual which is phenotypically superior with respect to economic traits such as timber, wood quality, fruit quality, chemical profile, etc. We also can go for hybridization. In fact, when you go and select a plus tree, it's a big challenge. If there is a plant species that has never been attempted for selection, then obviously you have to go and select it in a natural forest where you do not have any control over the age. As against, if there is a species like teak, you have plantations already, you have complete control over the age. So that's why we have divided the selection methods into two. We have two groups of methods here. A person who is going and selecting in natural forest will follow a subjective grading system or a mother tree selection system or regression selection system. Let's look at each one of them in some small detail. A subjective evaluation method is very, very simple. If you are an expert, you have been working on a particular species for a very long time, go and select based on your experience. You exactly know which kind of a tree grows in what rate, in what kind of site conditions. Based on your judgment, a tree is either selected or rejected. When you start a tree improvement program for the first time, this is one of the very cheapest and quickest method of achieving some amount of genetic gain, though it is not a very foolproof kind of a method. In fact, the best method or the ultimate way of selecting a particular tree species is the mother tree selection. It's a kind of it's a kind of a selection which is a backward selection. What we do is, first we identify phenotypically superior trees, collect the seeds and grow their progeny. These are the mother trees, these are the seedlings from the mother tree that will be grown for at least about one third to half a rotation period. And after that, either we select a particular tree or reject a particular tree. So here I am going to select a particular tree based on the performance of the progeny. So this is a kind of a backward selection that we are following. And the product of a mother tree selection is always an LI tree. And that's why you can be 100% sure about its performance whenever you release it as a variety into the farmer's field. That's why, though it's a long duration, it takes away almost 20 years for you to come out with one particular individual, but yet for a fast rotating species like eucalypts or casuarina, one can follow this, and this is the best way to select the tree. A regression selection system is one which actually has an extremely very good importance in selection in a natural forest. When you go to a forest, you find trees with all different ages. A tree is bigger basically because of its age. We do not know whether it is because of the age and coupled with its own genotype. In order to tease out how age is actually contributing to the performance of an individual, we go for a regression selection system. Here, we sample around 50 to 100 individuals and determine its age and a character of our interest. So as a particular tree ages, the volume also increases, or it could be any girth may increase. And we go for a regression. So there is a positive regression between the age and the volume. And when you go for a selection of a tree, if a tree that you are selecting falls above this particular line, in the sense that this particular line represents an average performance, and if your candidate is better than the average, then we can go for selectioning this. That means at a lower age, this particular tree is actually performing better than the normal tree. So that's how this is important. One can follow this regression selection system whenever we cannot control the age as a plantation. And in case of even age plantations, we can go for mass selection, family selection, seed selection, progeny selection. I will not be going to the details of all of these, but to make a mention that a family is nothing but if you have a tree, collect the seeds and grow them, the family is ready. So these are called as half-seed families. In case of a family selection, either the entire family is rejected or the entire family is selected. We can also use clonal selection in a similar way. Instead of collecting, In the previous, we collected the seeds and grew the offspring. Here we can collect the vegetative parts and then grow them as a clone. In fact, there is a particular terminology that needs to be again reiterated. The tree that is actually selected as a mother tree is called as an artet. The group of ramets is called as the clone. From a particular artet, you can take millions of ramets, but from a particular artet, you can only get one clone. So one plus tree, you will get one clone. One of the remarkable things that has been achieved off recently is that in order to make a clone, you needn't have to resort to the stem cuttings and the tissue culture. You can also use leaf as a material to make your clone. So through a kind of a inspiration that we drew from Tamil Nadu farmer, we could be able to now say that or show that in case of cinnamon, we can also have rooting of the cinnamon can be now made through a particular leaf. So this is an important issue that the clonal forestry will become an important issue. Whenever we go for a selection of a species, we first of all look at criteria. What is economically important trait that we need to look at? Is it a timber? If it is a timber species, we go for tree height, clear bole height, DBH, so on and so forth. All these characters are important while selecting a tree. It's always a multi-trait selection that we do when we are selecting. So in case of a timber species, we go for, these many characters are considered and then a particular tree is selected. In case of a pulpwood species, you have many characters like specific gravity, lumen diameter, so on and so forth. And if it is a NTFP like the Garcinia gummigata, which is a fruit yielding tree, you have these. So based on the importance of the character, based on the objective of the breeding, the characters to be selected or to be considered while selecting a particular tree changes with our different kinds of examples here. So medicinal plants, if it is a Saraka Ashoka tree, I would like to give more importance to the bark thickness, plant height, chemical profile of the alkaloid and seeds per seed yield per tree, etc. If it's an aromatic species like Mammia suriga, which is an important NTFP species too, you can follow these. So these are different kinds of criteria that we follow in different selection systems. Coming to the hybridization in tree improvement, when we speak about hybrids in forestry, it's always a interspecific hybrids. Intraspecific hybrids are existing, but they are very, very slow. So in case of tree species, natural hybridization occurs. For instance, in this case, you have a long leaf pine and a short leaf pine. Whenever they occur together in an area, for instance, this is the long leaf pine geographical range, and this is the short leaf geographical range of the short leaf pine. And you have in gray, you find these are the overlapping ones. So in these such areas, you find an F1 hybrid. These things can be directly used for selection. So if you have about 20, 30 clones of this particular hybrid, we can test it out and select it. So in fact, natural hybrids have been identified in pines, in acacia, in eucalypts, and by and large in our nation, perhaps terminalias may have a huge amount of natural hybrids, and perhaps these have to be selected more carefully. In fact, one of the celebrated examples of using of an interspecific hybrid for commercial production of wood comes from Vietnam, where there are more than 2 lakh hectares of this commercial interspecific hybrid has been done of Acacia mangium and Acacia auriculiformis, a Vietnamese scientist led by Professor Lee Dinh Hakam. And then he actually has made this. It's very simple that these natural hybrids will be selected and then they will be felled to make the copy shoots. And these copy shoots will be converted into clones you check out the clones for 3-4 years, and those clones which are doing extremely better will be propagated. And then just this is a kind of a one step or two step tree improvement, which is being followed by all the clonal forestry. In fact, the whole $1 million industry of clonal forestry depends upon this particular method. And it is one of the most quickest method to follow to get the maximum genetic gain. In fact, hybridization has also helped to survive or to revive one particular very good example from American chestnut. In fact, the example of American chestnut is a celebrated example of hybridization followed by selection. You remember that this American chestnut was one of the most important tree species found in United States of America. More than 4 to 5 billion trees were found, but unfortunately, because of a disease called chestnut blight, which was actually imported from China, again from China, way back in 1900, American chestnut, in fact, was attacked. And then today, this is almost at the end of extinction. There is a local extinction of American chestnut in the entire America. But it has been revived, but there were methods tried to control this particular disease. Chemical method, fire and quarantine did not work. So what they resorted is to go for an interspecific hybrid. And in the interspecific hybrid, they also went for the backrush method. This is the American chestnut original one. And this is the donor which is resistant to blight. So what they did was they went for, first of all, a kind of a hybridization, interspecific hybridization was done between the Chinese tree and the American tree. And then, as you can see here, every time you backcross with the American chestnut tree, the genome content increased. And at the end of fifth generation, they started tree interbreeding among the backcross progenies to get one American chestnut tree, which is almost something like around 98% American, 2% Chinese coming from for the resistant to Chinese blight or the chestnut blight. This is one of the very celebrated examples where over a period of more than 4 decades, this has been achieved, and the revival of the American chestnut has happened because of the tree improvement program. The fourth step of tree improvement program comes from how do we mass produce? Suppose you have one particular Chinese or American chestnut which has been revived. How do we make billion copies of it? In fact, there are several examples of how do we make billion copies. Vegetative propagation, tissue culture, these are all extremely simple. And then very celebrated examples do exist with respect to eucalyptus, as well as casuarina, where the vegetative propagation has been achieved. But in case of species like the tree, teak and pines, we go for seed production areas and seed orchards as the most important step in mass producing it. Without going to the details of seed orchards, we have two kinds of seed orchards. One is a clonal seed orchard. Second one is a seedling seed orchard type that we follow generally to mass produce these ideas. What we do is we select a particular cluster here and clonally propagate, establish a clonal seed orchard. But the establishment of clonal seed orchard itself is not an end by itself. We do not know, because our selection is based only on the phenotype, we really do not know whether all the clones perform better or not. So what we do is we take these clones and perform what we call it as progeny test. So if for the progeny test, we take the seeds from the mother trees, grow them, and then whenever there is a performance of a particular mother tree is good in the progeny test, we retain them and cull off all the other mother trees. So this is called the first generation. And likewise, we can go for generation after generation or the cycles of generation. And every time we are purifying, taking out the rogue ones, and then we are retaining the best genotypes for ultimately to make the seeds and then the seeds coming out of such a tree, seed orchard, will be released for commercial production. We can also do for genetic testing. I'm going to skip this particular thing. So what we do in tree improvement is we select the tree species, individuals, to by any method. We grow the first generation. By doing such a selection, we would have achieved about 10 to 15% increase in the economic returns. And this will go for one cycle of, again, purification, and then that will increase up to 20 to 25% of genetic gain. So likewise, if you go for two or three cycles, we can go up to around 35% increase in the genetic gain. So suppose you get, let us say, one unit of timber from a particular unit area, by going for at least one or two cycles of selection, we can increase up to around 35% of increase in the yield, thereby you know, giving a lot of productivity increase in this. And I will just touch upon genomic approaches, which has now become an extremely important tool today for the tree breeders. We need not have to wait for a very long time, decades together. By adapting this particular genomic approaches, one can identify local adaptations even to the climate change and match to the future. So the major objective of a tree genomics project is to understand the structure of the tree genome, how exactly the tree genome looks like, what is the kind of base pairs that you have, how many genes are controlled, etc., and identify and understand genotype-phenotype relationship, and then monitor the adaptive gene diversity and develop the genomic-based tools. In fact, we have been fortunate enough in the College of Forestry CC to release one draft genome of the tropical timber species, that the teak, for the first time, Indian teak. This was actually held by, the entire program was held by the IFGTB Coimbatore. The College of Forestry was one of the collaborating institute. We, for the first time, have produced the draft genome of teak in India, which has given us a lot of inputs regarding what kind of improvements can be now made through the genomic approach. Essentially, we ask three different questions, like, you know, what kind of, how many genes actually govern these traits, and then what kind of distribution effect is there, and then what is the distribution of relevant genes within the genome. So despite in the recent years, today we do not have a very good example also today where the adaptive traits have been identified. We are still trying to do that actually. So one of the major experiment that is going on in Canada is about the adapt tree experiment, where more than 250 species populations of large pine has been identified. They have been subjected to growth chamber experiments with annual temperature, mean annual temperature simulated as 1 degree, 6 degrees, and 11 degrees. And then those populations which perform better will be again subjected for the further selection. And then they will be identified. The genomic predictions will be made, and then genes that are responsible for giving adaptations to the increased temperature tolerance will be identified. In fact, this particular technique has now picking up a lot. And of course, in India, we have not started anything on the genomic selection, but once it comes through, this would open up a great avenue for the tree improvement to happen in India too. In fact, towards this effect, we have started our work with respect to the, again, Dicerzel malabaricum. We have now identified the genomes that are specific to specific population. As you can see in this panel, you can see here, these are the groups of tree species that are coming from the northern part of the Western Ghats, and these are the southern parts of the Western Ghats. They do not share a common gene pool very clearly. And whenever we want to now try it out for selection, we can clearly make selections distinctly from the northern part and the selection part and the southern part. Thereby, it will give us a better control over selection process. Such things are actually coming up right now. In fact, the final stage of a tree improvement program is that when we start our species, when we start our tree improvement, the species will have a very high genetic diversity but very low productivity. But as we go from selection of provenances, breeding population, tree, allied population, and the production populations, we would have achieved a great amount of tree improvement. But at the same time, as the level of improvement starts improving on the x-axis, the genetic variability would reduce to a very great extent. If this is the genetic variability you find in a wild population, by the time we achieve a single clone, the genetic diversity would have been extremely low. This is not an ideal situation for us to grow, basically because future is unpredictable. We really do not know what is the fate of this particular clone. So the current thinking is that there must be a mixture of clones. These clones should have an extremely high level of improvement, and the productivity at least match a higher amount of variability. So to secure the future, it's also important to have a genetically broad-based population for us to go about in the future. So friends, gene conservation can be done through increased utilization. This is a new concept. Suppose you have a wild population without any improvement, there will be continued to harvest from the wild, and then there will be genetic erosion coupled with decreased utilization. Suppose you have an improved material, you have an increased utilization, we have increased access to the quality material, and then because of that, there will be reduced pressure on the wild population. If you continue to harvest from the wild population, there would be increase in the pressure on the wild population. This is how the tree breeding can also have an impact on the conservation of native populations by weaning away the pressure from the natural forest to the plantations. So that's why tree improvement is one of the most important aspects in tree conservation as such. I end this particular talk by giving a kind of a genetic gain that is achieved in at least teak. Till date, we have achieved something like around 17% genetic gain. And then people have identified that the cost of tree improvement will be still be sufficient to cover if you have at least 10% gain. So 17% gain is a very good gain. In fact, my friends in the IFGTB, Coimbatore, have achieved almost 35 to 40% genetic gain increase using the Casuarina interspecific hybridization, which is one of the most wonderful contribution of any institute to the country. Likewise, the tree improvement is actually contributing a great to the nation building. But at the last, I would also like to make a flag, an issue, that what is the status of tree improvement in India? I did this exercise using a FAO source book after completing half a decade, half a century of tree improvement in India. We now know that there are about 272 species that have been actively managed for productive aims. It could be teak, it could be eucalyptus. Of them, 30 species are exotic, around 242 species are native. The genetic variability has been estimated only for 104. The tree improvement, actual tree improvement programs have been started only for 145. But the commercial seed production has happened only in 27 species. And these 27, out of these 27 species, exotic is around 21 species. That means we still lag behind, far behind than other European and other countries, Western countries, in terms of increasing our effort to bring in commercial seed production to the farmers. And moreover, you should also look at this particular graph, where of the 145 species that have been tried for improvement, species, the provenance trial has been done for 114, sorry, a provenance trial has been done for 114, species, and then plus three have been identified for only 62 species. Seed orchards have been established for only 58 species. And the clonal trials have been done for only 18 species, out of which only 8 are native, 10 are exotic. So that way, we have an open question. We have a huge amount of opportunity in front of us to exercise, practice, and every biologist, every botanist now should take up the kind of selection that can be now made. And with a simple selection of plus trees and making them into clones and testing them in multi locations, one can achieve a great strides. And then with that, I take this opportunity to thank once again the university authorities and the honorable vice chancellor and all of you for this wonderful opportunity to share my thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a very well delivered talk and very wonderfully received as well, as we could see from the response of the participants. Now it's our duty now to transfer the participants' questions to you. I'll request Dr. Suresh to do that job. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Nagraj. So first of all, good morning to all of you. So it was very informative presentation, and I am very happy to see that a couple of questions are coming up. So we will try to cover all the questions. So I will read the questions one by one for you, Vasudeva sir. So the first question is from Sanjit Kundu. His question, is it audible, sir?
Yeah, it's audible, yeah.
Okay, sir. So his question is that why conventional breeding, which has a much better role to play in genetic improvement of trees, is not given much importance in research?
Okay. This is actually a political decision. Basically, it's a political decision. If you look at number of scientists working on, let us say, a species like rice, maize, and wheat, there are thousands of scientists who are working. But a forest scientist who is trying to improve a tree species, a particular scientist have to work on one dozen species. That is one thing. And as such, tree improvement requires a huge investment to start with in the human resources. So identifying the right kind of forestry graduates to take up this particular tree improvement program and then encouraging them to take up a large trials at every forest college is the first step. And in fact, it's a policy decision to be made at the highest level. I think it's time we should start giving the right kind of importance that the forest tree improvement rightly deserves it.
Okay, thank you, sir. So another question is from the same participant. So he want to know that what is the efficiency of geophysical methods to map tree root systems?
Oh yeah, this I may not be able to answer this particular question right now. But what I really have understood is that if you want to map the root systems, perhaps the best thing is to dig it out. And then if you want to look at the studies on the root system, perhaps the stable radioisotope method is perhaps one of the best methods to identify.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question is from Lavanya Prada. So her question is that when we grow a particular species alone more, will it cause ecological or genetic disturbances?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Yes, sir. The question is, when we grow particular species alone, that is monoculture,
yeah,
will it cause the ecological and genetic disturbances?
Yeah, correct. So monoculture is always bad. There is no doubt about it. But what we are actually practicing today is to take out the forest land and making a monoculture. But the tree improvement, what it suggests is, do not touch the native forest types at all. Native tree populations have to be conserved as such. The products of the tree improvement have to come for captive breeding. It have to come to the farmers' field or the industrial captive plantations away from the natural forest. So conservation of natural forest is of the prime importance. We should never touch it. The tree improvement product should never go back to the forest, basically because we have left with very little amount of native tree populations. So the tree breeding aims at improving the yield and the productivity of timber outside the forests, particularly in farmers' field, industrial houses, captive plantations. That should be the most important thing. And when we do that, monoculture is not an important thing at all.
Thank you, sir. So next question is from Lakshmi. She wants to know that, is there any intraspecific tree hybrid?
Yeah. So in fact, in pine itself, we have interspecific hybridization has been done. In fact, interspecific hybridization has been done for increasing the vigor. So especially in large pine, I think we have a very successful interspecific hybridization that has been done.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question is from Subhashish Das. So he want to know that whether tree improvement have any influence on soil quality of an area.
Okay, so we actually had an opportunity to examine, myself and my colleague, Dr. Rajesh Gunaga from the Navsari Agriculture University. We did an experiment on identifying what would happen to the soil quality if we go for a seed orchard or a seed production area. And what happens to the soil quality, what is the influence of the tree species on the soil? Most often, it is actually the tree species that affect the soil rather than the soil affecting the tree species. So in fact, in most of the tree species, the soil factors would increase. Suppose, of course, in case of teak, there is a slight decrease in the soil quality. But when we go for other native species, because of the importance in involvement of the litter to the soil, there would be an increase in the soil quality.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question is there any possibility of genetically modified trees or seeds to escape from their particular plantation area and disturb the surrounding environment?
Yeah, this is an hypothetical question that is being pondered upon, and because of this particular fear, today we do not have a in India we do not have a genetically modified tree has been released. In fact, genetically modified trees exist in China, in America. Maybe the poplars are the first one to have been done, and we fear that there is definitely some kind of a chance, specifically when there is a lot of chance of interspecific hybridization. You know, the highly related species can have easily interspecific hybridization possibility. Under such circumstances, if there is a genetically modified tree, wind pollinated like pine, and when there is a swarm of this the pollen grains that go to a native untargeted population, and then it can pollinate, and definitely there is a chance, and we really do not know how to avoid this. What the scientists are actually doing it is to make the genetically modified tree male sterile. So you also make a genetically modified it for improving the yield, improving, let's say, insect resistance, but you make it sterile so that this particular problem may not arise.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question is from the Mahinder Singh. So he want to ask that, is every time hybrids are superior than their parents?
Oh, no, not at all. Definitely not. In fact, I can tell you one small joke here. Perhaps this goes back to one English poet, Shakespeare. Shakespeare, as you know, was not a very good looking man, but a very intelligent man. One very nice, beautiful dancer came to him and said that she wants to have a baby with him. Shakespeare asked, why? See, you are an intelligent man, I am a beautiful woman, and our baby, if our baby has both the intelligence of you and the beauty of me, it will be wonderful. But Shakespeare said, what if the opposite happens? So in fact, most of the times when we make a hybrid, opposite happens. That's why if you have 1,000 hybrid parent hybrids that are there, you may have to select one or two which are most important, and then either clonally propagate it or tissue culture you can do. So the question is that hybridization does not produce superiority always.
Okay, thank you, sir. This was it. So thank you very much, sir, for this informative lecture and good discussion. So next.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. I'll leave the.
Okay, sir. Class.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So next to the Nagra, sir. Thank you, Dr. Suresh. Without taking any more time, I think we should head for the next session. To start with, our second, I will introduce our second speaker of today. He is Shri Sridhar Bhatt, who has a very vast experience in the field of wildlife conservation. He is the recipient of a prestigious GIS Award in the year 2014 for his contribution in the field of wildlife conservation. He has more than 26 years of experience and expertise in the field of wildlife studies, conservation, biology, and ecology. His field skills are excellent and have reached more than 8,000 people through various activities. It is very heartening to mention that more than 450 of his pupils are working in the Forest Department in center as well as the state. So thank you very much for your time, sir. We are very fortunate to have such a experienced speaker with us. Now it's over to you, sir, to present your talk, and we'll have some questions later at the end of the presentation.
Nagraj, so my PPT is ready. Just guide me through steps in a minute. So I have to put share screen, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, then click on, okay.
It's coming up.
Okay.
Yeah, make it full screen and you can start, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, is it fine?
Yeah, it's very much fine. It's up to you, sir, now. Okay.
Okay, thank you for the introduction, Dr. Nagraj. I'll be speaking about wildlife conservation, why and how. I'm Sridhar Bhatt at Forest Ecology College, Sirsi. First of all, let us understand the definition of wildlife. People view a lot of films, documentaries, National Geographic, Discovery Channel. They discuss about wildlife. But however, for most people, wildlife means large animals such as elephant, tiger, lion, deer, etc. But wildlife is not just these large animals. As per definition, wildlife includes all non-domesticated animal species and uncultivated plant species, and together they constitute wildlife. They can be as large as a Dipterocarpus indicus tree to as small as a moss or a fern. They can be in case of plants, and in case of animals, the wildlife includes an animal as large as the blue whale and as small as a mosquito. All these come under the purview of wildlife. Even microbes are wildlife. And the word wildlife has come from the meaning that it is not tamed. They are not tamed by humans. And often there is a statement with a lot of socioeconomic problems, lack of resources, land is lacking in such situation, and sometimes there can be threat to human life or crops or livestock in by carnivores or large herbivores. So yes, often there are some problems from wildlife, and in the midst of such problems, should we conserve wildlife? This is sometimes asked, and it is more so asked outside India than in India. Nevertheless, all over the world, such questions are asked, and the answer is yes, wildlife do deserve active conservation for several values, joys from them, and uses of them. What are those values and uses? I would give first priority to the aesthetic value of wildlife. Simply, they are beautiful. They are there, they are beautiful, we need them. And looking at the commercial value of wildlife and all that, I think it's very mean of humans to think of the commercial value. I will come to that later, but aesthetic value, the beauty of wildlife. It is said, I think this is in Bible, the statement, man cannot live by bread alone. And I add, humans need many more amenities. And beauty of wild places, their inhabitants, they are very important for the emotional well-being and health of humans. These days, you know, we talk about psychosomatic diseases, you know, these disorders that are caused by our mentality or lack of peace. And in all these, the aesthetic values of wild life and their habitat pictures a lot. And wild places, they were the origin of much of the spirituality and culture of humanity. I do not want to dwell on this last point because that will take almost 5-6 minutes. But remember, all the prophets of the world, they spent many years in wild places and not amidst humans. I am sure none of the prophets would have been happy to sit in this place, nor in this place. You can understand whether we like these places or not. It's caused by us only, humans only. So wherever human density is high, we create such scenes. I think all are looking at the picture, and I will draw some contrast. Yes, for last couple of slides, you saw how clean they were. You could smell them. And now look at this scene. There is a bench. One or two of you can think of spending time in the evening, sitting here, enjoying the calm, the aesthetic value. So I hope you can draw the contrast between the polluted lots and clean places. I'm talking about the aesthetic value of wildlife and their habitat. That was about aesthetic. Then about ethics, morality. Most of the wild species came into existence even before humans. And we who came later in the course of evolution, we do not have the right to destroy them and, you know, make them extinct. Whereas I think protecting them should be considered a trust that is given to mankind. Remember, Gandhiji used to talk about trusteeship and such a trusteeship. So he was talking about the trusteeship in socio-economic sense. And whereas I am talking about humans, we should consider wildlife and their habitat as a trust given to us to protect. Then about the ecological value. So I am talking about aesthetic value, ethical value, ecological value. Further, I'll be talking about cultural value, medicinal value, commercial value, biological value, etc. Ecological value of wildlife. Remember, humans are just one species in the web of life. The web of life is very complex. Each species is a strand. And if we consider that such and such a strand is not important and we tear away the strand, finally the web collapses. And when the web collapses, humanity cannot avoid collapsing along with the web. So therefore, the web of life is very important. And for that, wild systems are very necessary. I'll give you certain examples. One is wild lands. They are the benchmarks to compare ecosystems and rangelands. You know, there is a stream of science called rangeland science, and rangeland management is there. It's very popular in North America, Europe, where pastures are kept for livestock or wild animals, to herbivores, to graze freely. After hundreds of books and thousands of articles, yet the rangeland scientists in every paper, finally they tell more studies are needed. How many animals are optimum for a particular area? How many animals can be grazed on an area so that the area doesn't decrease in its health? When such questions are asked, final answer is not given by those scientific articles. They tell more studies are needed, even after thousands of studies. Whereas in the case of wild lands, our wild herbivores, they tell we don't need any more study, we have the answer right now. How? So for instance, Nagarhole is a wild land in Karnataka. Kaziranga is a wild land. Kaziranga is perhaps one of the most productive protected areas of India. Scientists who have studied the number of wild herbivores there, they consider the wild herbivore density as well as the tiger density. It is highest in Kaziranga National Park because it's very productive in the Brahmaputra floodplain, floodplain grassland. Even in such area, there are an estimated, wildlife scientists have estimated about 80 grazing herbivores per square kilometer in Kaziranga. In Nagarhole, they have estimated about 60 grazing herbivores per square kilometer. Whereas in India, the domestic, the livestock density is more than 150 per square kilometer. This is exactly the reason why there is overgrazing, soil erosion, soil compaction. Because of soil erosion, siltation in dams, and seasonal floods because the dam capacity gets reduced due to siltation, and runoff happens due to soil erosion and lack of infiltration. So why all these environmental problems came? Because we have such a huge density of livestock, more than 150 per square kilometer. Whereas the wild lands clearly tell that the number of herbivores that can graze can be 40 per square kilometer, 60 per square kilometer, 80 per square kilometer, and 80 is in the most productive area. This is one comparison which we can draw from wild lands. And if we do not have wild landscapes, we cannot draw these comparisons because we will be having only human-dominated landscapes. And Dr. George Schaller, the hero of wildlife, are these, because he has put almost 75 years into wildlife study all over the world. He's a big name in the field of wildlife. He called predators as the best wildlife managers because they decide how many herbivores can be there in a system. So these wild lands are managed by predators, whereas our human-dominated landscapes are managed by humans. And therefore, we have problem over our land, and wild lands do not have such problems. Of course, when I say wild land, they have to be quite large enough. I'll come to such points next. To tell about one ecological relations, I was talking about the web of life. 2011, there was one workshop in Sirsi, Uttara Kannada, Karnataka, the place where I stay and teach. There was problem from monkeys in this region. The workshop was to discuss about that. And it seems one of the farmers said he has a solution, that he used old fishing nets to protect his crops from monkeys. So he put the old fishing nets all around the crop field, like a fence, so that monkeys did not come in. He thought that is a solution. But it seems another farmer said, no, that's not a solution. It is creating a problem. What is that problem? It seems rat snakes used to get caught and killed in the fishing net. You know, unlike humans, rat snakes do not have the brains that humans have. We are very clever in so many ways. Rat snakes are innocent animals. They have just ordinary brain, and they do not know that they have to come move back to escape from the fishing net. They will obviously get caught in the fishing net and get killed. And when that happens, it seems the other farmer said, rodents increased in their numbers inside the groves, and the groves started having problem from rats and mice. Okay, so we tried to avoid one problem of monkeys, but a new problem came, that was of rodents. So this is about the ecological value of wildlife. Another example, say for instance, bees, butterflies, they are very important for pollination. It's impossible for humans to pollinate crores and crores of plants, which are very valuable source of our food. Okay, it has to be obviously done by bees, bumblebees, butterflies, etc. We can never do their role. However, some 4 years back, our students, they said, sir, we are going to conduct International Bee Day. I think this comes sometime in September. If I am not wrong, it may be on the third Saturday of every September, International Bee Day. And at that time, one of my friends, Balachandra Hegde, who has traveled over 28 countries in the world, he's an MSc in ecology, PhD in ecology, had gone to so many countries. He had come to me on the same day. Then I said, friend Balachandra, our students are going to conduct one function on International Bee Day. He said, yes, yes, that's very important. In Europe, Germany, and all that, bees are almost locally extinct. And in Germany, if somebody is selling a packet of tomato seeds, along with that, the seller is also sending one packet of bumblebees to pollinate. I thought it's a joke. Then he said, oh, no, it is true. They have lost their insects which can pollinate. Therefore, they are selling their insects also. I checked it out in the internet. It was true. And I also learned the same day I checked in the internet. I also learned that in China, for apples, pollination is done by hand by people because pollinators are lacking in number. This is the damage we have caused to the system. And this is another example of the ecological value, ecological relations that wildlife perform. I'm quite happy to recall one game played by Center for Environment Education, a very interesting game where they illustrate the importance of these species. They illustrate the importance of these species with the help of a silk thread, a game played with the help of silk thread, where 30-40 people together play that and show the importance of each species. Once again, I cannot be going into the details of that game. People interested can approach or join some workshop by Center for Environment Education. You can very well understand this. Another is, large landscapes in the name of wildlife, they help conserve viable populations of so many organisms, including, say, vultures. Vultures are now critically endangered. Our long-billed vulture, white-rumped vulture, slender-billed vulture, red-headed vulture, all these are endangered or critically endangered. Till 1995, they were quite common and numerous, whereas now they are critically endangered. And a lot of effort all over the world, especially in Southeast Asia, to conserve vultures. I had gone to one or two places where there are some three vultures, four vultures over a landscape, and there is vulture conservation group there. And both these sites are in Karnataka, and they are pointing about, they are quite concerned about two or three or six vultures present there. And a conservation reserve has been nominated for that place. In contrast, what can happen? What is the potential in a wild landscape? That's mind-boggling. Long back in 2017, one of our students who had gone to Pench, one Mr. Ashwin, he gave me some photographs of vultures breeding, inhabiting cliffs near, I think it was in Cane River. You might have heard about Cane Betwa Link, which is near Pench Tiger Reserve. He was telling those cliffs are in threat because of the proposed project. And he showed me several photographs of vultures flying there, nesting there, breeding there. And in 2014, Dr. Ullas Karanth was telling about 45 long-billed vultures over a kill in Bandhavgarh. 2 years back, one of my former students, Keshav Murthy, he had gone to Nagarhole. He was telling about 15 white-rumped vultures. This February, I had gone to Bandipur with 60 of our students, the director of the Tiger Reserve and our students. Many of us, they saw 36 vultures at a place. So friends, please compare. Three vultures, six vultures, four vultures, over a human-dominated landscape where we are making a lot of efforts to conserve, whereas unasked, unhindered by us, 45, 36, 15, 20 vultures being conserved over large wild landscapes. This is the importance of wild lands conserved in the name of wildlife. This is the photograph of those vultures our students saw in February. 36 vultures were seen. And one of the students, one Chandan, he photographed juvenile red-headed vulture. That means breeding is happening there. We cannot be seeing this breeding happening over human-dominated landscapes where there can be 400 people per square kilometer. He also photographed a white-rumped vulture. I was talking about bees, their importance in pollination, bumblebees and all that. And I had told you the story of a lack of pollinators in Germany, China and all that. And India is fortunate. We still have those bee colonies, rock bees in our forest areas over large cliffs. These bees are still there. And that's a fortunate thing we have. We should conserve them. And it is possible because we still have forests and wild landscapes. Another value, so I was talking about aesthetic value, ethical value, ecological value. Talking about commercial value, we have heard about ecosystem services, hydrological services from forests. Forests do not allow rainwater to run away. They make it infiltrate. They add to the groundwater aquifer, and as a result, we start getting year-round flow of clean, sustained water. Otherwise, without forest, there will be floods in rainy season, peak floods in rainy season, and no flows in dry season. All over the world, people are recognizing the ecosystem services from forest, including the hydrological services. But for those services to be intact, the forest should be healthy. If the forest is not healthy, what do we mean by forest not being healthy? Lopped a lot, it is browsed a lot, so people have cut, it is a namesake forest. That forest cannot be healthy and the hydrological services cannot be provided so easily. For instance, you have a contrast here. There is one agriculture land, forest land. Hypothetically, in the agricultural land, the arrows showing upwards, they represent evapotranspiration, and arrows going downwards, they represent infiltration. In the agricultural land, evaporation will be more and infiltration will not be as that efficient as in forest. So I have not based this picture on any study by me. This is a hypothetical situation. Somebody interested who is doing studies on hydrology, especially forest hydrology, can very well do such comparisons taking small watersheds. It would be extremely interesting. I stress upon this point because in India, such studies comparing the hydrological value of forest versus non-forest areas, such studies are very much lacking. And as a result, the value of forest is underestimated. Say, for instance, while a dam is being built, people talk about benefit-cost ratio. If the hydrological services from a forest, they are underestimated, obviously the benefit from forest will be less. That means in the benefit-cost ratio, the cost factor will be shown as less and benefit factor will be shown as more. Okay. So for such reasons, the hydrological services and ecosystem services need to be estimated. And if the forest is to cultivation is to other users, that equation is unfavorable. That means if cultivation is more, forest is less, then the whole society will have to face water shortage. Say the district in which I am placed, which has about 76% forest and 24% non-forest. Another place in the Deccan Plateau of Karnataka, which has 16% forest, only 16% forest and 84% non-forest. Karnataka state has 20% forest, 80% non-forest. India, 21:79. I do not know I think Mizoram might be better placed in this sense. It must be having higher forest cover, and without forest, say even grasslands also perform such good functions. They are also very good at infiltering water, and the Deccan Plateau of entire India, Deccan Plateau lost its cheetah because of hunting. Cheetah was a sign of health of a grassland. We lost the cheetah, we lost the blackbuck, we lost the valuable wild grasslands. Everywhere it's humans and their cultivation. As a result, lack of infiltration of water, shortage of water, borewells have to be dug for thousands of feet, and ultimately water problem for farmers, and a lot of the suicides of farmers are linked to scarcity of water. And how did we arrive at that? How did we arrive at this socio-economic problem? Because we did not recognize the worth of wild grasslands, sufficient grasslands, and good ratio of grasslands in the dry region and good ratio of forest in the wet region. Here is a photograph. Before 2017, I saw one film on Aghanashini. I learned that it is available on the YouTube on river Aghanashini. Aghanashini is in Uttarakhanda district again. One Mr. Ashwin Kumar and his team, they produced this film, very much available on the YouTube. You can see here the one with the muddy water is the main river Aghanashini, and another smaller river joining this Aghanashini, that smaller river has clean water. So Aghanashini is the one with muddy water, and smaller river is Bennehole, a tributary to Aghanashini. And this is in the peak monsoon, in the high rainfall weeks, and you can understand Bennehole is flowing with clean water and Aghanashini is flowing with muddy water. Why? The catchment of Aghanashini is deforested. It is not healthy, and the catchment of the clean water Bennehole is well forested, and you can very well see this on the Google map. So this was the situation in 2017, and people may tell, no, this may be just a stray case. Every time it may not happen. Oh, this is the same year, same film. I have got a screenshot with the help of one of my former pupils. That was in 2017, and 2018 heavy rainfall season, monsoon once again. Yes, the same situation. Muddy waters, river Aghanashini, because of damaged catchment, and clean waters, river Bennehole, because of healthy forested catchment. And 2019, because I followed up with the help of asking local forest department people. Some of these photographs are provided by beat guards, watchers, range forest officer. And 2019 also was the same situation. Well forested versus non-forested. In another stream, same situation. You can very well understand what happens if a landscape is covered by forest nicely and if it is not covered by forest. So this is the hydrological value of forests. And these muddy waters will obviously lead to a lot of floods, they will lead to siltation. Another set of photographs I got from Sanctuary magazine in 2002. See, this is showing a bullet going through a tiger. Tiger skin is shown. You can see a bullet hole in that. So tiger is killed. What happens next? Tiger is killed means forest is killed. Forest is killed means water is killed. Water is killed means humans are killed. Not just humans, the future generations themselves are killed, because you can understand by the, there is a child here. So the future generations of humans are in threat. This is to talk about locally about how siltation has occurred in the dams. And in the earlier lecture, you heard a beautiful lecture by Dr. Vasudev sir, and he was talking about tree improvement. And obviously in all improvement programs, wild sources, wild stocks are very important. progenitors of almost all domesticated cultivated species were wild ones, and they are still important for any improvement. There are numerous stories of the rice called Indian rice 8. There can be stories on wild banana, and you know, wild life are important for their biological value, biological control, breeding for disease resistance, breeding for new characters, and all that. The cultural values of wildlife. In India, all over the world, wildlife, they have their own cultural values. You know, humans are called cultured animals, and without culture, humans just become animals. Okay, you can understand the difference between cultured and just uncultured situation. India is full of such mythology where each animal is culturally so important. It could be domesticated or it could be wild. Elephant, elephant is, Ganesh is elephant headed, and a lot of, peacock is the vehicle of Shanmukh, and many examples like that. And in 98, I saw one beautiful situation. There was Ganesh Chaturthi festival in Sirsi, and there was procession. And in the procession, the Tibetan colony people from Mundgod, again in Uttar Kannada district, that colony people joined the procession. And I was very awestruck by looking at the mask of an animal they wore. That mask of the animal was not of our buffalo, not of our, it was not of our cattle, but it was of the yak, which signified their cultural identity. You know, they are from the Tibetan landscape, from Ladakh and other landscape, and they used the, the horn and the face of yak, and that was very important for their cultural identity. People have cultural, they identify tiger. There is place for tiger in their culture. There is place for tiger in the cricket tournaments played by young, by our youth. And, I'm not just naming tiger. So many other animals are there. So black buck, crows, they all have their roles to play in our rituals. And from the northeast, the Mithun, Bos Frontier, even in Mizoram, I heard the Mizo tribals value this Mithun, and it has a lot of cultural values. Obviously, this has been derived from gaur, a wild cattle, and our domestic cattle, a hybrid of gaur and domestic cattle. The last 25 years, the Parsi community has been in a lot of dilemma because vultures are not there to feed on the dead bodies. This is about the cultural importance of vultures, cultural importance of wildlife, vultures. The Parsis, they do not bury the dead, they do not burn the dead. Instead, they used to throw the dead body, the carcass, onto towers of silence where vultures would have fed on the dead bodies. So that was very unique way of funeral. But during the last 30 years, vultures have disappeared. As a result, Parsi community is in a dilemma how to conduct the funeral of the dead bodies. These are all the towers of silence that were constructed thousands of years back. This from, say, in Iran, such places. Say, Christmas trees, the cultural value of wildlife. Christmas trees, they are very important for Christmas. Without a conifer, Christmas is incomplete. This is about the importance of the plant. And there is medicinal importance of plants, which Vasudev has dealt. And problems for wildlife, habitat loss, fragmentation, overcollection, these problems are there. And when fragmentation happens, the wild animals, they lose their habitat and their numbers go down a lot. Drastically, 90% of their density abundance goes down. And this needs more time for explanation. I'll skip this. And how to conserve wildlife? Human population has to be controlled and our lifestyle has to be simpler and our thinking has to be higher. This picture tells about how was the human population less in the past and there was sufficient place for wildlife. With increase in human population, the wild animals have lost their habitat and their numbers have decreased. And what can each person do? See, at least fortunately, India is a democracy and we should speak, we should be vocal for conservation of wildlife. See, wild animals, they cannot go to the police, court, MLA, MP, they cannot hear out the ministers, and they will, if given a chance, they will survive, otherwise they will die off. Therefore, I told you, their conservation should be a trust given to us, trust taken by us. Each of us who value, care for wildlife, should speak for wildlife, vote for wildlife, lobby for wildlife. People who destroy wildlife habitat in the name of developmental projects, for developmental projects, they can lobby, they can speak. But because the listeners are people, the speakers are people. Whereas for wildlife, the listeners are people, but the speakers are not wildlife. Therefore, the wildlife lovers, those who care for wild values, they should be speaking, should be overt for sake of wildlife. You know, our government and the Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, asks, so write to mygov.in, write to Narendra Modi app, give suggestions for Mann Ki Baat. We should make use of such situations, such chances to speak for wildlife. This is just a picture. The great Indian bustard is telling that it cannot speak, it doesn't have a vote, and people may not care for it. The administrators may not care for it. Therefore, wildlife lovers should speak for it. So also for other wildlife. There are still hopes. We should speak about wildlife conservation. This is one traditional mode of valuing tigers. So this is a tiger god which is worshipped in Uttar Kannada. I heard it is worshipped in Maharashtra also. Such cultural values, they are very important for wildlife conservation. I have spoken about what the importance of wildlife and watch what each individual has to do for wildlife conservation. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir, for a very nice presentation. Now it's time to take some questions and answer the queries of the participants. I'll now request Dr. Suresh to transfer the questions to you.
Okay, thank you, sir, for this interesting and informative presentation. A lot of questions are coming. I will take few of them due to the time presented. So first question is that, is it good to make rules to lock down the wildlife site visits?
Please repeat the question again.
Okay, sir. Is it good to make rules to lock down the wildlife site visits?
No, total ban on that is not good. You know, there should be votaries for wildlife. Somebody has to speak for wildlife. If tourists do not see wild animals in the habitat, the importance of those wild animals as well as the habitat cannot be realized by the society. So some amount of visits to wild places are very important, but they have to be optimum. Too much density of such visitors will be damaging. So I suppose I have answered the question.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question is, what are the effects of electromagnetic radiation on avian fauna?
On avian fauna?
Yes.
I have heard some occasions like that. Say, for instance, people are telling that the electromagnetic radiations, or say the mobile towers, are harming sparrows. From my side, I feel there is not much to support such thinking, because I have seen sparrows in the town where I reside. I have seen sparrows moving about on the mobile towers themselves, and a lot of sparrows on trees just adjacent to the mobile towers. More research has to be forthcoming. As of now, I cannot tell anything conclusively.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question is, how we can reduce man-animal conflicts?
There are several ways. One is, if the conflict is happening because humans are sitting in the middle of a corridor between two protected areas or two forest patches, rehabilitating the people can be one. And of course, I skipped that slide where which talked about fragmentation of forest areas. If people are living in the middle of forest, small pockets of villages are there in the middle of forest, obviously conflicts will be more. At least in chosen protected areas, if the people can be humanely rehabilitated, people also will be happy. Wildlife also will thrive inside. This is one win-win situation, both for humans as well as for wildlife. This is about one thing about habitat. Another is, if we can understand the behavior of wild animals, and if we try to adjust to that, the conflicts can be reduced. I have heard that in Tamil Nadu, tea plantations, there are mechanisms that have reduced human-elephant conflicts by warning the people, cautioning the people, elephant herd is in such and such a place. So very nicely, I heard that they have brought forth the use of technology, mobile message will be there for the people who are moving about, that elephant has been sighted, herd has been sighted. So human-elephant conflict, it seems, has been reduced there. By understanding the behavior, say for instance, if we keep our dogs and goat outside, leopards may come to feed on them, and obviously there will be conflict with humans. And if we just take them, keep them inside, well protected, leopards will not come so much in search of them, and the conflict will be reduced. I have told you some three answers.
Yes, sir, yes, sir. So I will take now the last question. So the question is that, what is the current situation of wildlife conservation in India?
See, in terms of the habitat remaining, still it is present. The hopes are still there. The government is pro-conservation, and Indian culture is steeped in the myths of wildlife conservation. People are wildlife conservation friendly. Even in the midst of difficulties, the Indians are friends for wildlife. I have heard of so many situations. So if you ask whether it is hopeful or hopeless, I would say it is still a hopeful situation for wildlife conservation in India.
Okay, thank you, sir. So a lot of other questions are also coming, but due to time constraint, we can't cover all the questions right now. So all other relevant questions will be redirected to the respective speakers through email, and the answers will be sent back to the participants. So thank you very much, sir, for this.
Thanks.
So now we are towards the end of this webinar. So now I request to the Dr. Nagaraj Hegde to present a vote of thanks. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
It's a very busy day in Mizoram University because three more webinars coming up today till 8:30 p.m. So that's why even though some 5-10 minutes are there, but we are not taking all the questions so that the next speakers have to adjust themselves. Okay. So now it's my duty to propose vote of thanks. First of all, let me thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor for sparing his valuable time. In between so many assignments, he always makes sure that he is present for any type of research and academic activities going on in the university. So we are very much thankful to him. Thank you very much, sir. Now coming to today's two speakers, firstly Professor Vasudeva for delivering a very informative and wonderful speech, and also taking his valuable time and sparing with us. So thank you very much, sir. Now, Dr. Sidharpat, sir, I am also extremely thankful to you because during this difficult situations, pandemic situations, you are sparing your valuable time and giving our participants, our students, and other participants who are joining from all over the country an opportunity to get a very informative and provocative lecture. Thought provoking lecture, I'm sorry. So next up, for all the series of webinars going on in our university, the system experts are working day and night, every day since last 1.5 months at least. Especially Mr. Suraj Singh, his efforts are very important for making this webinar a very grand success. Thank you very much, Mr. Suraj. And finally, without participants, and no program is successful. We have been seeing so many queries, so many appreciations to the speakers and the valuable lectures from the side of the participants. So thank you very much to all the attendees and participants. Once again, Professor Vasudeva sir, now you are on screen. I thank you profusely for sparing your time and delivering a very wonderful talk. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. Yeah,
yeah. I think with your permission, let me end this webinar.
Thank you
very much, sir. We'll catch you soon. Yeah.